some musical circles, it was said that the Jackson 5 is nothing more than a black version of yet another family musical enterprise, the Osmonds. Berry Gordy admitted that this was indeed his idea to begin with, setting up one against the other, with the sole purpose of boosting record sales. And, says he, it worked. Those who would feel the pangs of jealousy were in awe when the Jackson 5 broke through in the United Kingdom and could count members of the British royal family among their many fans. The Jackson rage is at its peak, prompting the creation of a TV cartoon series based on the five brothers. Michael says, "Every Saturday morning I would sit in front of the TV screen, and I found it fantastic to see my cartoon double on the screen." Michael's present-day talent for the world of fantasy dates back to that time. His world is made up of few personal friends. His life is going from performance to performance, to the accompaniment of screaming fans and thunderous applause, and from recording studio to recording studio. The upshot of this is that to this very day, every time he finds himself with a group of people. On the other hand, he's totally at home when on stage. He says, "If it were up to me, I would even like to sleep on stage." In spite of the success of Never Can Say Goodbye, this is surpassed by Michael's and Germaine's solo efforts from 1972 onwards. Germaine's Daddy's Home skyrockets on the hit parade, but he's forced to take second place to Michael's Got to Be There, Rockin' Robin, and especially Ben, a very moving ballad, which makes many a teen heart beat faster and is awarded with a gold record. As a group, the Jackson 5's success at the time leaves something to be desired, even though the music they're producing is keeping pace with the times. Dancing Machine and Get It Together, both are excellent examples of quality soul music. The hysteria surrounding the five is subsiding. It's unavoidable, and in 1975, the five brothers, feeling limited in their possibilities with Motown, decide to sever their ties with Berry Gordy's Hit Factory. One more Motown LP, and then there follows the signing of a lucrative record contract with Epic. The switch does not prove to be all they hope for, since because of this purely commercial agreement, the very close-knit Jackson family has to lose one member of the group. That, sighs Michael, threw a spanner in the works. In 1973, Germaine Jackson marries 19-year-old Hazel, daughter of Berry Gordy, and the marriage is one of the most glittering affairs of the Beverly Hills social season. However, it places Germaine in a difficult position. He must choose between the family of which he has long been a member and the other, made up of Hazel and their now expanded family, which includes two children. He opts for the latter. An understandable and courageous choice, but it leaves the group without one member. Michael recalls, "Father had a hard time coping with the shock. Although we found Germaine's decision to leave the group a sad one, we respected his choice. He remained our brother, and his choice was not between two families, but rather between two record labels." Germaine chooses personal happiness, and his professional career goes into a slump. The year is 1980, and then Stevie Wonder becomes involved in his work, and Germaine, now more self-confident, gets a well-deserved hit. It's called Let's Get Serious. Manager Joe Jackson convinces 13-year-old Randy, already an accomplished percussionist, to take Jermaine's place, and he quickly becomes integrated into the band, a band which now, under epic contract, is known as The Jacksons, since the name The Jackson 5 is owned by Motown and Berry Gordy. It's a poor start for The Jacksons, which is also the title of their newest LP, in which their fans barely recognize their idols. Blues Away just doesn't have it, and the future looks very bleak for them. But then there comes Goin' Places, and the group is again headed in the right direction. The Jacksons now enter into what is known as the Philly sound, but it's something which Michael and his brothers could very well have done without. The brothers decide at the time to take matters into their own hands. 1978 becomes an excellent year. The brothers are also their own producers, and their first LP, their first very own record in every way, is Destiny. Michael says, "We cut most of the tracks in our own studio at home, and it was the first time that our performance on record was equal to that of a live performance on stage." The Jacksons are about to win back the hearts of their fans, thanks to worldwide hits such as Blame It on the Boogie and Shake Your Body Down to the Ground. Thanks in no small measure to ex-Stevie Wonder musicians Nathan Watts on bass, Greg Fillinganes piano, and Michael Maniac Cembello on guitar, the road to success lies wide open for numbers such as Lovely One and Walk Right Now. They all give their best to Destiny. Furthermore, this particular LP also shows up the unmistakable talent for composition that Michael and Randy have at their disposal. The brothers Jackson are doing extremely well, but what of the sisters Jackson? Only Maureen, the eldest, chooses a tranquil life of home and hearth. LaToya becomes a superstar with the release of her debut LP, which includes the disco smash, If You Feel the Fun. The youngest of the Jacksons, Janet, tries her hand in another show business field and very quickly becomes a successful and celebrated television actress. In 1980, the Jacksons confirm the good impressions obtained with Destiny with their newest LP, Triumph. It's an excellent marriage of production, arrangements, and sounds, not to be outdone by I Am from Earth, Wind, and Fire, which is released at about the same time. From the discotheques, the sounds of Can You Feel It pour forth. Years prior to this, Michael gets his first film role, something of which he has dreamed for a long time. He plays the scarecrow hunk, opposite his spiritual mother Diana Ross, who plays Dorothy in a series for the young called The Wizard of Oz. Michael's acting talents are lauded, in spite of the fact that the series itself receives lukewarm reviews. But Michael is in his element. I felt so much like Hunk the Scarecrow who wants brains that I even slept in my outfit. I love the idea of being able to reach millions of people at one time. From the soundtrack, The Wiz, also comes Michael's first solo single since his break with Motown. It's called You Can't Win. During the shooting of the film scenes, Michael is introduced to composer-producer Quincy Jones, who has already earned his spurs with such artists as the Brothers Johnson, George Benson, and Rufus. Quincy Jones would play an important part in Michael's future solo career, a future which also included the disco-funk release Off the Wall. Off the Wall features a new Michael Jackson, a more mature young man, the first black artist to master rock, disco, and pop. Brother Germain, even today, readily admits that Michael is the most talented of the Jacksons. His music is fresher than mine because it contains such natural dance rhythms, he says. For a short while, a veil of silence seems to envelop Michael Jackson. But then, towards the end of 1982, his fans' patience is rewarded. Thriller, the second Jackson Jones LP, becomes the record of the year in 1983. And singles taken from the LP, The Girl Is Mine, Billie Jean, Beat It, Wanna Be Startin' Something, and Human Nature, take the music world by storm. More than 15 million copies of Thriller are sold, and critics call it the perfect record. With success in the palm of his hand, Michael Jackson starts living more and more as a recluse. While his brothers share their lives with their families, Michael lives with his parents, while his imposing mansion, called Never Neverland, is being completed. His only companions being the animals in his private zoo, a boa constrictor, a llama, a lamb, among others. I don't have many friends, says Michael. I'm constantly followed by fans, and that's not always nice. Even after posting round-the-clock guards at the house, people still try to climb the walls or get into the house. He has only a few true friends. Most of his acquaintances can be found in the select circle of show business personalities. Tatum O'Neill, Stevie Wonder, Brooke Shields, Paul McCartney, Jane Fonda, Liza Minnelli, Fred Astaire, and of course, Diana Ross, whom he regards as his second mother. As far as girls are concerned, his mother, Kathy, would like to see him married one day to his dream girl. But being a superstar makes the choosing all the harder, says she. It's very difficult for him. Everyone knows that he's terribly rich. And how to differentiate whether a girl really wants him or only his money. It's part of the price of superstardom. The price to be paid for being Michael Jackson. This has been his story. The story of a young man who has become a living legend during his lifetime. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Jackson. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Jackson. That's how he's welcomed today by his thousands of admiring fans. A superstar, about to go on stage and give of his talents. This is the story of Michael Jackson. Only in his mid-20s, he's been at the top for 10 years. No mean achievement in the world of entertainment, where stars shine but for a short while. But for the story of Michael Jackson, we have to go back to the 40s. Joe Jackson is employed in the metal industry in Gary, in the American state of Indiana. In his spare time, Joe is a guitarist with the Falcons. One fine day, he meets Kathy, who, besides being beautiful, also happens to be a talented clarinetist, as well as a reputable blues and country and western singer. Their marriage in 1950 is later blessed with three daughters, Maureen, LaToya, and Janet, and five sons, Jackie, Tito, Germaine, Marlon, Michael, and Randy. To dedicate himself completely to his family, Joe hangs up his guitar. It's soon obvious to Joe that his second son, Tito, has that special feeling for music and often strums his own chords on his father's guitar. Joe is in seventh heaven and decides to give Tito and his older brother, Jackie, guitar lessons. Mother Kathy also gives them instruction in their first singing lessons. Maureen also proves to have a gift for the piano and violin. And when little brother Germaine starts taking his first musical steps, nothing can stop Tito from organizing a family orchestra. Germaine is appointed bass player and solo vocalist. And before they know it, they are the biggest attraction at all the local parties and musical manifestations. But Tito is not satisfied with only local success. And so, with Sister LaToya as backup vocalist, the Jackson family takes to the road, covering the Chicago area, and booking success after success with their cover versions of such Tamla Motown stars as The Temptations and The Miracles. They're on their way. The only thing they still lack is a real frontman. One day in 1963, Kathy finds 5-year-old Michael imitating Germaine in front of a mirror. The boy is a natural, and within short order, takes over the solo slot from brother Germaine. Marlon, 1 year older, decides to try show business along with his 4 brothers. Tito, at the ripe old age of 10, decides to have his dream come true. The world didn't know it yet, for the Jackson 5 had just been born. Their first official performance as a group is at the Roosevelt High School Annual Fair in 1963. The parking lot is filling up fast with large American cars. Backstage, a little chap is standing there chewing gum and blowing gigantic bubbles. There's nothing to indicate that this nice little kid is about to go on stage and become transformed into an electrifying showman. He becomes alive. Gone is the bubblegum chewing youngster. And in his place is a miniature version of James Brown. Handling the microphone and dancing the boogaloo like a star, the Jackson 5 are working for their money and working hard. And their public keep asking for more. Michael still remembers those performances as if they took place just yesterday. As soon as we started singing, he says, people would start throwing money at us. And with a chuckle, he adds, I still remember stuffing my pockets so full of dollar bills and coins that I needed suspenders and a belt to keep up my trousers. After every show, he says, I would buy enormous quantities of candy and eat it all in a quiet corner when no one was looking, because Mother would never have allowed it. In 1967, Father Joe decides that his boys have adequate experience to become professional. And when, 1 year later, his good friend Richard Hatcher is a candidate in the local council elections, Joe Jackson suggests that the Jackson 5 perform on his behalf during the election campaign. And Joe says, if the voters have then not carried you off on their shoulders, it's only because the surprise of it all has turned them into pillars of salt. Richard Hatcher, a longtime fighter against black oppression, becomes the first black mayor in the United States. To celebrate, he hires the local civic auditorium and brings in Diana Ross and the Supremes as top of the bill, along with a Jackson 5. These little guys will surprise you, Miss Ross, he says, as Jackie, Germaine, Marlon, and Michael storm onto the stage. In the interim, 2 cousins have been added to the group, Ronnie at the piano and Johnny on drums. Diana Ross could hardly believe her own eyes when seeing this 10-year-old explode into song and dance. 15 years later, Diana Ross would say, in Michael, I saw my own reflection as a child. That little guy was a born superstar. Diana speaks with Barry Gordy at the record company where she's under contract. This you've got to see. These brothers are absolutely phenomenal, she tells him. Following a brief telephone conversation, Joe Jackson and the boys are on their way to Detroit, the Motor City, and home of Tamla Motown. Mother Kathy remains at home with the girls. She has heard the squeals of the audience during performances, and she knows that her boys are on their way. Michael and his brothers, on their way to making music history. Michael recalls the day he first entered Berry Gordy's Motown office with the words, "On the wall were an impressive number of gold records, and everywhere were photos of my idols, Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, and the Temptations. I was really impressed and couldn't imagine that my brothers and I would one day be up there among them." Berry Gordy also remembers that day. He says, "Especially Michael struck me immediately. I was convinced that after little Stevie Wonder, here was another child prodigy who would go a long way." He lost no time in appointing Joe Jackson their manager. They were introduced to the American public with the release of an LP entitled "Diana Ross Presents the Jackson Five." Mr. Gordy was the overseer in their artistic and financial departments. The Motown Music Factory has gone into a slump, and Berry Gordy wants the Jackson 5 as the company's showcase, whatever the cost. He introduces them to the Corporation, the name given to Motown's three most outstanding musician-composers, Fonso Maisel, Freddie Perren, and Deke Richards. The very first Jackson Corporation collaboration is a bullseye. The Jackson rage is gathering momentum, and the airwaves come alive with a Jackson's "I Want You Back." No less than 2 million copies are sold, and Diana Ross's prediction is proved right. 11-year-old Michael Jackson attains super status. His quickly established fan club is inundated with thousands upon thousands of letters. And to an equal number of teenage girls, he becomes their knight in shining armor. But instead of a white steed, he has a favorite teddy bear with whom he cuddles up every evening as the lights are turned off in his bedroom by 9. For the Jacksons, their lives are suddenly changed. No longer could they attend their usual school. It has become a meeting place for countless photographers as school is let out. And the school itself is constantly being hounded for autographs. Michael Jackson says, "My brothers and I were forced to go to small private schools." "I Want You Back" is followed in 1970 by three equally successful singles, ABC, "The Love You Save," and "I'll Be There." In their live performances too, the Jackson 5 proved to be the undisputed sensation of the year. In their green-white outfits, they steal the hearts of the former Temptations fans. And with their stage personality, they steal everybody's hearts. Their music is passionate, honest, and lively. And furthermore, all the group's members are between the ages of 11 and 17, something which appeals to the youth of America back in the 70s. The Jackson 5. It was the new face of the new generation of Motown artists.